The sound of the guitar cut through the silence of the night, capturing the attention of the 40-some-odd high schoolers who were gathered around in a circle. Some faces turned downward in exhaustion, others staring off into space, lost in their own thoughts, many more blinking away tears. The simple melody calling us together at our final time together was now hitting home. It was a time that most of us looked forward to for different reasons, but now that it was here, it was as though the moments slowed to a crawl. I sat there on my sleeping bag, thinking to myself, why in the world was I feeling such an overwhelming wave of emotion, particularly to a song that all of us had become quite accustomed to? But let me back up a minute. I'm speaking of something that occurs on First Congregational's work camp, an annual mission trip where high schoolers from this church are able to go out, gather together, board a plane, bus, or van, and in unity with one another, escape from their parents to another state. Actually, from a church mission standpoint, this is something that we take great pride in. Work camp is meant to build community and strengthen relationships, not just among one another, but among the community that we're ending up serving. We engage in service projects anywhere from repairing homes to painting, building, shingling, and cleaning, not to mention half a dozen other chores of intense manual labor. Again, it's something that we are extraordinarily proud of as a teaching church, something that is extremely meaningful to our community, not just as a sign that we are encouraging our young people to go out and participate in a community outside of our own suburban surroundings, but also instill a value of service that we might not otherwise encounter outside of this. During my time in high school, I had a chance to go on all four of these trips over the years. And yet, despite all of these lofty goals and idealized pictures that we bring home, viewing the culmination of this event is something wholly different than being in the midst of something that at the time appears anything but beautiful. Let me see if I can paint a brief picture. From the morning we start out, we gather together in a church parking lot, 40 some odd teenagers herded on to some form of mass transportation, in which there's a subsequent stampede in an attempt to try and find seats next to friends from high school while attempting not to lose our bags full of clothes in the process. Since I was normally on the losing end of this particular scramble, I often solve this predicament of sitting next to strangers by pretending to sleep for the next 5 hours. Then, of course, comes the next challenge for our unfamiliar adventure, sleeping arrangements. Since we're given the freedom to place our sleeping bags wherever we would like, there's often another scuffle in order to set our sleeping bags either on the cold tile floor of a gym or the hard carpeted padding of a large youth room, which inevitably creates these penguin-like clusters of teenage bodies all desperate for the warmth of friendship. As you can imagine, this doesn't lend itself very well to quiet hours after lights go out. After a long day of hard work, socializing is always a pretty high priority for these kids. And being on what I would like to consider the lowest tier of Maslow's hierarchy of needs for teenagers, there isn't much room for other basic human functions, the primary of those being sleep. You see, the adults on work camp seem to have this crazy idea that if they force us to get up at some ungodly hour, it'll inevitably make us realize that we should just go to bed earlier. Right. At about 1 a.m, when the harsh whispers of "go to bed" are still ringing throughout the room, we've normally made our point pretty clear. Though in the end, it seems as though our fearless leaders always seem to get the last laugh, when, bright and early the next morning, they put their plan into action. Every year at work camp, the chaperones picked out a song that they thought would make a good morning wake-up call. By that, it had to be a song that would rouse a room full of teenagers from their deep slumber. So as you can imagine, this was something loud and annoyingly bubbly enough to force us to get up and leave the room, else endure a track stuck on repeat until we did. The first notes of whatever Christian artist it happened to be this year were like nails on a chalkboard after the first couple of painful mornings. But eventually, through some very interesting methods, we all eventually got up and the song stopped. And so, sleep deprived and filled with puberty, we begin our day. After rolling out of bed and scarfing down a cold breakfast, we would change into our dirty and paint-stained clothes, head out into the summer heat to work on a roof or backyard, doing anything from shingling, painting, or shoveling mulch for hours on end, with the only breaks coming during lunch or for water as the day wore on. It was hot and sweaty work that often lent itself to a shared common experience, both during when this was happening and once we returned back to our air-conditioned sleeping locations. And if that weren't enough to exhaust us mentally, we then came back and at the end of the day participated in what we called circle time, which was a time for us to gather around and share our thoughts, watching as the singular talking stick slowly made its way around the circle. And since there were normally no guidelines as to what exactly we were supposed to talk about or time limits, this exercise frequently felt almost as laborious as shoveling mulch all afternoon. But over the course of these days, I quickly found the facades and social barriers that we carried with us into this week quickly deteriorating under the harsh conditions we all experienced together. You could tell we'd reached the halfway point to these end when the clique of tight-knit girls who always somehow managed to creepily finish each other's sentences started getting on each other's last nerves. Or more seriously, when a freshman jock and a senior band kid gathered together in an empty kitchen late at night and talked about previous work camps of those who had come before us. We began to see who we were beneath what we pretended to be otherwise back in the suburbs. And for me, it was often quite surprising to discover what lay beneath. The hard work and long hours wore on us as we looked forward more and more to the final night of our trip, but not so that we could get a full night's rest. No, we had something else in store. The reward for a brutal week of work and reflection was an all-nighter, where sleep was for the weak, or smart. This long night of struggle was a bittersweet time, which often culminated in a game of Bible trivia at about 3 in the morning. You might be thinking to yourself, Bible trivia? What a mature and wholesome game for a bunch of sleep-deprived, angsty teenagers to play at this point in time. That would be until you discovered that Bible trivia was just our code name for a churchy version of Truth or Dare, with the dares normally consisting of finding some creative way to go and harass Seth. Our pride was ultimately telling our chaperones we just wanted to play Bible trivia, pulling out a box which somebody had actually bought, pulling out a couple of cards of Bible trivia and reading them to our chaperones in order to hoodwink these omnipotent adults. We were all in on it, too. Our little secret. This code became so repetitive that we almost forgot exactly what Bible trivia was. Now, of course, no need to fear. I'm sure Rachel has brought down the hammer on any sort of shenanigans like that these days. And as we sit here, we can smirk at the foolishness of high schoolers' futile attempts to hide their intentions or shake our heads at their rebelliousness. it's on the lighter side of youthful indiscretion, one that carries little weight outside of the judgment of those outsiders looking in. But I do believe that there is a more weighty aspect to a story of Bible trivia. There's a deeper, darker analogy that runs through our community and society as a whole when we remember that childlike transgressions are not for children alone. In the bluntest sense, we're all deceivers who claim to play Bible trivia in front of those on the outside in order to hide what's really going on the inside. We are no less guilty of trying to hoodwink those who are so easy to judge or mock us. And this isn't necessarily in the sense that we're doing something wrong per se. Rather, we would simply just wish to avoid unwanted attention or questions about breaking from the normalcy of our surroundings. We are conditioned to dress up any quirks, eccentricities, or even life bruises with a thick layer of makeup so that the world might perceive us to be something that we believe that they would prefer to see. Deep down, I don't think that we're really partaking in the upright game we are pretending to play, despite how well we may have been convincing even ourselves at an uncritical glance. Of course, though, this isn't necessarily unique for our time. The Christians, during the time Ephesians was written, had the same sort of problems with honesty that we have today. In an identity emerging in the marginal places of society, this group of individuals often struggled with the perception of the larger community around them, as well as the ideas of those among their small group. There was always that lingering question of who to trust and how honest you could be with outsiders and with newcomers to the small circle of Christians. How authentic would these people be in the face of a society that would reject them for living into these ideals? Now, it's certainly a noble and right thing for those who chose the high road. And I think certainly sitting in the comforts and security of a building like this, we can look in awe and wonder at those who are willing to face persecution from the government, from religious leaders, and from their neighbors themselves. Of course, though, in a society that tends to shy away from conversations about authenticity in the face of overwhelming and indiscriminate judgment, we often fall into the category of those less discussed or remembered by history. Those who chose to dress up their lives in something a little less conspicuous, a little more normal. For some in the community of Ephesus and surrounding cities, some separated, others chose to disguise their true intentions with codes. But all the same, they went quietly into the night, going with the stream. Ultimately, they were unable to bring themselves to say what they actually stood for and who they actually were. I think that despite the fact that our little work camp group sought to hide our true intentions from the prying eyes of adults, there was something going on under the surface. I had mentioned before that the last night was often filled with emotion as we got to know our peers and chaperones in an open and truthful way that wasn't always pretty or easy, but it was honest. We heard from those who were moved by our work, by the community we had a chance to share, and by the fun things that we couldn't experience anywhere else but work camp. But I think that the moments I found most moving was in the dissent. When a sophomore interrupted the laughs to reveal how isolated he had felt during this week from his peers, or when a girl broke the silence to share that she feared returning home because her parents were always yelling at each other. weeks away from divorce. These statements interrupted the reality we had created with one another. It caused the real world to come crashing into our own. There was joy in the freedom from the real world that we had been granted, but there was also sadness that it would come to an end, and anxiety about what lay in store for us when we returned to our lives hundreds of miles away, where our problems would continue to be there day after day. At the end of this time together, sitting in a circle, we listened to the silence, taking in the complex flood of emotions that filled the room. It was at this point when one of our chaperones moved his guitar in front of him and started strumming a strangely familiar tune. It was the same melody that had rudely awoken us every morning from our final sleep, but in the circle together, this particular rendition sounded different. There was something meaningful. Whether we enjoyed our time at the week or couldn't wait to rush home, whether we reflected on the excitement of work camp or worried about what lay in store for us when we were to head back to the real world, this song cut through the noise to remind us of the mornings we shared together, those painful experiences, of the meals that we ate during our exhausting afternoons, and of the honesty and memories that we got to share at each night's circle time, managing somehow to create this intricate web of friendships in just a matter of days. This summer, I had a chance to go to the National Youth Event with many of our Christian Ed leaders and so many of our incredible high schoolers. This was kind of a surreal experience for me because this was the first time chaperoning kids in a church where I was a kid myself not long ago. But watching those high schoolers pull onto the bus in order to get seats next to their friends recalled vivid memories from my own work camp. Turns out not much had changed in Maslow's hierarchy of needs for high schoolers, and I still pretended to sleep to avoid talking to anyone I didn't know. But for me, what was at the heart of this journey was something I had experienced in different times, in different forms, and under different circumstances. The long, hot days of moving across the large campus of Purdue and the short, uncomfortable nights of sleeping in strange beds wore on all of us. We just didn't have the energy to keep up these facades of who we wanted to be coming in, and there was certainly frustration in the fact that we couldn't maintain this guise. Our final night together, as we sat out in the balmy summer evening, getting eaten alive by mosquitoes, we just wanted to be done with this so that we could crawl to bed. And in the silence of the night, suddenly an unexpected dam of emotions broke open, catching us all unaware of how vulnerable we were in this moment. We were only hours away from returning to the real world once more, so close to escaping unscathed from this critical introspection that was thrust upon us. In these moments of genuine emotion and unfiltered community that followed, I heard stories about how some of these teenagers had walked through hell and back before even getting to high school, and how some of them were in the midst of this painful journey right now, feeling lost and alone. It wasn't an easy or pretty conversation with perfect answers, just as it wasn't when I went through high school, just as it isn't now as I go through this stage of life. But it was honest. It was vulnerable. and there was love amidst our small misfit group. Perhaps it's easier for the younger generations to wipe off this layer of makeup of the real world before it hardens into a protective shell, to experience those moments of vulnerability and love with people we barely know in a community such as this. It's so much simpler when we're younger, and who am I to say any different? But I'll defer to Paul in this matter and say that regardless of where we are on life's journey, we come into this place with the scars we bear, with the experience we have been granted to share on the other side, and with those who sit around us this Sunday morning. We are looking for something different than the real world around us, all the while aware of what we must face when we walk out these doors. To be a community of Christ, to welcome those into our circle, is to build a relationship that forces us to walk the difficult and joyous road. But however we do it, we must be present in mind and body. After the makeup comes off and the games we play are revealed for what they truly are, we, in our most genuine and vulnerable forms, find ourselves called together, reminded of our common bonds that don't end when we separate, but call us back time and time again, like the simple strumming of a guitar in the silence of a room, reminding us all of what we have been through and of the present we now share. Amen.